Sharpening Him is number 388. God has chosen me.
Your Son to heal the contrite of heart, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Came to call sinners, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Intercede for us the right hand of the Father, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We give you thanks, Lord, for your great grace.
O God, who manifest your almighty power above all by pardoning sin, pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to attain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Reading from the book of Numbers. The Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses, taking some of the spirit that was on Moses. The Lord bestowed it on the 70 elders, and as the spirit came to rest on them, they prophesied. Now two men, one named Eldad and the other Medad, were not in the gathering but had been left in the camp. They too had been on the list, but had not gone out to the tent. Yet the Spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp. So when a young man quickly told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp," Joshua, son of Nun, who from his youth had been Moses' aide, said, "Moses, my Lord, stop them." But Moses answered him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the people of the Lord were prophets. Would that the Lord may bestow his spirit on them all." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Rich, weep and wail over your impending miseries.
Your wealth has rotted away, your clothes have become moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like a fire. You have stored up treasure for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who harvested your fields are crying loud, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the day of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus replied, "Do not prevent him. There is no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Anyone who gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, will surely not lose his reward. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands into Gehenna, into unquenchable fire. If your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with two feet to be thrown into Gehenna. If your eye causes you a sin, pluck it out. Better for you to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My brothers and sisters, in a short while we will be in the gift-giving season. And some of us in the gift-giving season leading up to Christmas, sometimes it's a stressful thing. If you're like me, it's not as stressful. I'm a year-round shopper for gifts, you know, so like, you know, if I see something that would be a good gift for somebody, I buy it and I put it on a shelf in my closet so I know I have a gift ready for that person's birthday or Christmas, and then I don't feel flustered. So when it comes to holiday time or anything, so maybe that's a little tip there. But nonetheless, as I was kind of thinking about how quickly it seems that this year is going, and the whole idea that we're knocking on the door of gift-giving season, so to speak, one of the things that came to my mind as I was praying about our scriptures this week was a question of, do we take time to reflect or to think or to remember the gift that we are and the gift that we're called to be? Do we take time to think about the gift that we are and the gift that we're called to be? And certainly we know that all of us are given certain gifts and talents, and no two people are quite the same. Some of us have artistic abilities, some have ability for sports and physical activity, and other people have other different kinds of gifts and talents. But all of us have been given the basic gifts of a heart to love and to be merciful, a brain to absorb wisdom around us, eyes to see, and the other senses, all gifts from God, all gifts that we're called to cherish, and all gifts that we are meant to use wisely for the greater glory of God's kingdom and for others. I raise all of this because today Jesus gives another important teaching about life, and in particular as it pertains to what we call Gehenna, or otherwise known as hell. Perhaps this idea of hell is something that has been a little bit more relaxed in modern times. Maybe people have gotten too comfortable with the comforts of this world, or sometimes we kind of rest on the laurels of saying, well, I'm a good person. And I want to be very clear that the church is not out to say that you're not a good person. Jesus is not saying you're not a good person. That's not the argument nor what is being said. What the Lord is saying, and what the church affirms through its teachings, is that there is life within following Christ and his will, and there is no life when we choose to abandon, to walk away, or step away from the Lord. And in fact, there is a consequence, just like any action in this world, there are consequences, whether they be positive or negative, there are consequences to those actions if we step away from using all the gifts and everything that God has given to us and serve either other gods or abandon the Lord or separate ourselves from the love of Christ. But the Lord talks about the state of Gehenna. In other words, again, we know it to be hell. And the way in which the Lord describes it is very dramatic, because what he is using here, the term Gehenna in and of itself is a combination of two words in a way, coming from the Greek word G is G-E with a little on top of it. I know it's very technical accent on top of it. There you go. Sorry to all my English teachers of the past. So there's Gi and then Gehenna. So putting those two things together, you get Gehenna. And the latter part of the word is actually referring to a place called Hinnom. And Hinnom is literally the land of Hinnom. And in this land, especially we find in the Old Testament, it's in the valley east, southeast of Jerusalem. And it's described in the book of Jeremiah as a land where horrific sacrifices took place, cultic activities towards pagan deities. One of these deities was named a pagan god named Molech, in which they would sacrifice even children and other things to this pagan god. And so also in this valley of Hinnom, being a wicked place, it was also a place where inhabitants of Jerusalem would bring their garbage and their filth, their sewage, and so on, and there would be fires and stench everywhere. And so the Lord uses this language and this literal place to describe the status of what hell is like. In the vision that the children received from visitation or the apparition of Our Lady of Fatima, she also alludes to the status of the poor souls in torment and hell. That there are those who decide to walk away or separate themselves from the Lord, and it is an eternal punishment, an eternal suffering. But the Lord continues to use the imagery of this worm, an image that's been used throughout the Old Testament, which talks about the rot of the grave and of perpetual pain, and again, punishment, where needs and fire is not quenched. And this also, though, comes from Isaiah chapter 66. So it's not like Jesus is pulling this terminology out of nowhere. But in Isaiah 66, verse 24, we hear, "And they shall go forth and look on the dead bodies of the men that have rebelled against me, for their worm shall not die, their fire shall not be quenched. And so the Lord is giving a particular warning here to follow him and to follow his ways if we want to live in the fullness of life. And this is not a threat, this is not like a scare tactic into following the Lord, but it is to say that there are, again, other consequences to separating ourselves from the love of Jesus Christ. There are consequences to when we enter into sin, and especially the Lord says in the gospel today, when we lead others into sin along with us. Even so much so that he also uses a lot of hyperbolic language about various ways in which maybe if there's a sinful part of us that we can eliminate that. You know, for example, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off, or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. And I have to say that, also to pluck out your eye, and I think all of us too, if we took this literally, we'd be a bunch of like penguin walking pirates going into heaven, right? But truthfully speaking, maybe, you know, when we think about what it means to follow Christ and to follow the Lord, while the Lord is giving us important instruction and warning, we should not choose fear, though, either. We should not choose fear. And the sad thing is some people do. You know, sometimes some people choose to believe because they're simply afraid of the negative consequences or going to hell, but it's not a way to live, and it's not a way to grow in faith, and it's not a way to come to the Lord. But rather, the Lord, although he gives us these warnings, first and foremost, the Lord gives us the tools and the graces that we need to enter into eternal life through the church, through the sacraments, beginning with baptism, and then so on. And we receive the fullness of Jesus Christ into our very beings through the Eucharist, the grace that we need to live a life of grace, the presence of God within us. And then he also gives us, again, various tools like the sacrament of reconciliation for the forgiveness of sins, and then also, too, various forms of an examination of conscience. And maybe what we hear today, this hyperbolic language of the Lord, is a good examination of conscience for us. And so, for example, when the Lord says, again, to cut off your hand, if it causes you to sin, if there is something literally that we are doing with our physical hands that are inappropriate or contrary to God's will, to think about correcting that behavior. But even more so on a spiritual level, maybe we're called or we're failing to reach out to others in need, to engage the corporal works of mercy. Or when the Lord says, if your foot causes you to sin, to cut it off, again, and maybe we can think about the physical places that we go. Are we walking into quote-unquote dangerous neighborhoods, conversations of gossip or the like, or other things that don't lead us to a healthy relationship with God and with others? So are we walking into or going places that are unhealthy for us? And of course, too, one that's the most pervasive in our life today, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. And to think about, are we using our eyes to see correctly, to see how the Lord sees through the eyes of faith, with compassion, to see others with mercy and love, to see the world around us as God sees us? Or are our eyes wandering to places that they should not be, whether it be in the physical world, online, or other places? Are they wandering? Are we looking at things we should not see or should do not lead us to a deeper relationship with the Lord? Our awareness and our prayer and the grace that God extends to us is good news and says that there is hope for us. But at the same time, he gives us the tools to be aware of what we need to do so we may always follow his will, to cherish the gift that he has created and called us to be. And so, my brothers and sisters, this week, in our lives of prayer, let us heed this warning of the Lord and honor the gift that God has created us to be and to live fully with our will, as close as it can be to God's will, that we may do his will and enter into eternal life. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages,
God from God,
light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We place our trust in the Lord as we now make known to him our prayers and intercession.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That all chosen to lead our church do so with loving compassion and service, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those in government service regard all human life with sacred respect, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Steve Chyla, husband of Kay Chyla, may he enjoy the blessings of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are recovering from hurricanes and storms, that God will heal their pain, renew their hope and guidance, the assistance to them which they need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we hold in prayer all members of our faith community, especially those who are unable to join us at Christ's table. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may intercede for one another as we mention our many needs and intentions in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died in Christ, especially for Jim Gratz, whom we remember in a special way at this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, in your merciful love, for these our prayers and grant them according to your will. We ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Our offertory hymn is number 395, The Servant's Song.
Christ to you. Pray.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Grant us, O merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord. Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, for in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration. He was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion. He took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered to one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to a fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
With your spirit.
Let us offer to each other a sign of peace.
Our communion hymn is number 441, On Eagle's Wings.
In blue.
Let us pray. Yes, Heavenly Mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body that we may be co-heirs in glory of Christ, whose suffering we are united in whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Final blessing today, just a few announcements. The first of which is that we are beginning the inquiry process. Any adults that are interested in, if you know an adult who is looking into becoming Catholic through the RCIA or soon to be known the OCIA process, that will be kicking off in October on the 15th. And so if you know anybody that fits that bill, refer them to Sandy or reach out to Sandy in the parish office so they can get connected. For our youth in the parish, grades 9 to 12, our youth group retreat will be taking place next Saturday, October 5th, at the Litchfield site at 9 a.m. So if your youth are not yet registered, please do so on the parish website or contact Jacob at the parish office. Also, this is the last weekend to buy tickets for the month of prizes raffle fundraiser. We're going to start pulling tickets October 1st, and so those tickets are on sale after Mass, 5 each, 3 for $10. They're also available through the parish website as well. And last but not least, for Litchfield site, volunteers are needed Saturday, October 12th at 9:30 a.m. for the Litchfield site fall cleanup day. Lunch will be provided. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael,
the archangel,
defend us
in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and the snares of the devil. May God rebuke him,
we humbly pray.
And if thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God,
thrust into hell
Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world
as evil souls.
Our closing hymn is number 589, In Christ There Is No East or West.